Hello, and welcome back to another episode with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be looking at phase changes, specifically how to calculate and use the heat of vaporization and the heat of fusion to calculate heat. So whenever we have a phase change, what are we talking about? So let's say if I have a solid ice cube here in the middle, and it's made of all these little waters, all oriented in a very crystalline structure. You can see all the little solids all really close together. Now, as they start absorbing heat and start gaining energy as a result, they will start to move a little bit farther apart. The intermolecular forces will start to drift farther and farther apart as they gain energy, and it's going to start making a liquid as a result. Now, when that happens, right, going from a solid to a liquid, right, that is when we're referring to melting, right? And the opposite is all about freezing. So when we first melt, right, those intermolecular forces are really far apart. It goes through a phase change. That is when we have to use the heat of fusion to calculate the numbers behind that. Now, if that liquid is sitting there for a long time and it keeps absorbing energy, eventually what will happen is a lot of those little water molecules, they'll eventually break into the gas phase, making a big gas cloud where all of them are vapor particles. That can eventually ricochet and bounce off the different walls of the container that they might be in. And we would have to use the heat of vaporization to talk about that phase change, which whenever we are either going through boiling or vaporization, that is when it goes from a liquid to a gas. So we are going to be looking at that and trying to understand that complete picture in this video. So this is for introductory chem and slightly for Gen Chem 1 for a lot of students out there, but it's just the basics on how to use delta H and use that with moles to go through different calculations. So let's take a look, and if this is something that's really interesting to you, please hit that like button, sub to the channel, and you can see more videos on topics like these. All right, let's go into it. All right, let's start with the fundamentals, start with the basics. So let's first review of what I just said before, which is if you are having a change of state or a phase change, both these words are generally used interchangeably depending on who your professor is and where you are learning chemistry. So whenever we talk about a phase, we have a solid, liquid, or a gas. Same idea as states. We have a solid, liquid, or a gas. So if I'm going from a solid to a liquid, that is whenever if I take an ice cube and you were to have it in your hand, what is going to happen to it? Well, that ice cube is going to eventually melt, right? Now, if you take your melted water and stick it back in the freezer, well, that liquid, if you go backwards, is going to freeze. Now, when we have these phase changes, this is where the heat of fusion is going to be used, okay? And we'll go over what formula that will be required during that point. Now, when you have the other phase change, let's say if I go from a liquid to a gas, meaning that these liquid particles, these intermolecular forces are going to drift so far apart that eventually we're able to break the intermolecular forces, taking a lot of energy to do that. This is whenever we have, it's going to be considered to be boiling or vaporization to go into the gas phase. Now, if you were to take those gases, you were to cool them back down, right? They have a lot of kinetic energy. They're moving around because you put so much heat into them. If you were to cool them back down, well, that is now going to be referred to as condensation, is the cooling, right? Bringing it down. So we go through condensation. If you think of if you wake up really early in the morning when it's cold outside, you'll see dew on the grass, on everything that's outside. This is condensation. Now, when that happens, this is going to be referred to as the heat of vaporization to how to calculate these different values. Now, when it comes to heat, so usually what we'll use is the letter Q to denote heat. Now, when it comes to anything that's energetic related, we have to realize that there are signs behind these because there's endothermic and exothermic processes. So with this, if you were to have an ice cube in your hand and you were to hold it there, is it absorbing heat or releasing heat? And think about it for a second. Is what's happening to that ice cube? Is it getting hotter? Well, that means it's yes, right? It's absorbing heat. So absorbing is a positive value. So if you're melting, you're going to have a positive value. And if you're boiling, you're going to have a positive Q value. Versus, let's say, if you want to freeze it or to condense it, the ice or the water, whatever phase it is in, needs to lose heat. It needs to release it in order to get colder. So whenever we are going into the opposite process of condensation and freezing, that is going to be a negative Q value, okay? So it all depends on whether or not you are going one way or the other will reflect what you will see in your calculation. Let's take a look at the different formulas you will be using. So these are both of them here. So that for Q, both of these are depends on delta H fusion, delta H vaporization. Usually they have a little subscript that tells you which one you're going to use. So Q is our heat value when we are looking at this. N is always referred to as moles. And delta H is something that we call as enthalpy. But for most intensive purposes, it's just delta H effusion, just to keep it a little easier for most introductory students. So we're multiplying these two concepts together in order to calculate our heat. Let's take a look at some different examples of the kinds of problems that you will see and how to solve for this portion, how to plug in our different values for this. Our first example, calculate the heat when 36 grams of water is melted at 0°C. Okay, so how exactly do we do this? Well, it's going to require us to use our Q equation for a phase change. So this is going to be N times delta H, and being that's referring to fusion, usually it's abbreviated as FUS or fusion when we are seeing these equations. So the first thing you need to do is we have, what were we given? We need to stay organized with these things. We were given a mass value, which is 36.0 grams. That is not a mole value. And we were given a delta H of fusion. So what exactly do we have to do first? Well, if you can think of all of our different calculations when it comes to masses and moles, our goal is always the mole. So the first thing that we need to do is convert grams to moles. So one thing that I did here is include the values for how to get to molar mass, right? And if you need help with molar mass, refer to my videos on molar mass and using mole equations. So for this one, right, we have water is what's being used. So we need to add up one oxygen atom and two hydrogen atoms to convert this. So when we are doing this little calculation here for ourselves, and here let's make some room for ourselves, this is going to be 18 grams for water, and this is just rounded just to make it a little easier math on ourselves, and that's equivalent to every 1 mole of water. So that's going to be equal to 2 moles of H2O. Now, we have our mole value, and what we're going to do is we're going to plug both the delta H of fusion and the mole value into this equation up here, right? So we're going to plug both parts in. So 2 moles is going to go in for N, and then the 6.02 kilojoules is going to go in for delta fusion. So let's solve. If we have Q, that's going to be times 2.00 moles times 6.02 kilojoules per mole. And what we are going to quickly see is that moles cancels moles. And what we will be left with is 12.04 kilojoules for our answer. And we will round that to the same number as sig figs that we had in our original problem. So this will be 12.0 kilojoules. Now, is this positive or is it negative? Well, being that it was melting, it needed to absorb heat. So this would stay as a positive value, so 12.0. Now the follow-up question is how much heat is required to freeze the exact same sample? So instead of melting it, how would you freeze it? Well, think about it. One way is it's just all about the sign changes. So before, it was a positive 12.0 kilojoules to melt it, right? So what would it be in order to freeze it? Well, it's going to be the opposite. So it'd be negative 12.0 kilojoules in order to freeze it. It's all about how that delta H's sign changes. So when it comes to delta H of fusion for freezing, instead that would have been a 6.02, and it's negative for kilojoules per mole. All right, so the sign of our delta H changes depending on if it's positive or negative, whether we're freezing it or melting it. Let's go on to our next problem. To reduce swelling, a 237 gram ice pack is placed on the body. How much heat in joules will it take to melt the ice and warm up the liquid water to 37 degrees C? Okay, this is something that combines different concepts. So there's another video that was released at the same time as this one, which is all about specific heat. And there was a video released a few months ago on how to do heat as well. So this is something that it requires us to understand how do these energy diagrams look like. So at first, it talks about a phase change, right? We have an ice pack, the ice is melting. So whenever we have these diagrams, we got to refer to what the temperatures are. So in order for something to freeze, it's at 0 degrees C. So when, in order to convert that, it is a straight line that you see. This is referring to the ice pack melting because it takes so much energy for those intermolecular forces to get far enough apart so that way it can actually become a liquid. Now, afterwards, what was happening is it was heated up to 37 degrees. So usually what we'll see is a slope referring to heating. Now, if the slope was going the opposite direction, that would be cooling. Now, why do we care about this? This is because there are multiple heat equations at work here. We have what I refer to as Q1 and Q2, being that we're going to be doing two separate equations here. So now why do we care? It's because we want to stay organized. So Q1 is what we just did in our previous problem, right? N times delta H fusion, because it's all about how is this ice cube melting in your ice pack. Q2 is all about the MCAT equation, right? So it's MC delta T. This is something else that's covered in this type of chapter. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to figure out what the total heat that is required to cool this down. So in order to do the very last part to find the Q total, we got to add up Q1 plus Q2 in order to get our final value. So we got to do a little bit of work here. So let's first take a look at what we did last time. So the first thing we need is our mass, right? It was 237 grams is what is being given to us in the problem. 237 grams of water to be exact. So when we go through that, we need to convert that to moles in order to use our first equation. So 237 grams of water, in order to convert that to moles, we have to once again use our molar mass, which is 18 grams of water is equivalent to 1 mole of water. So grams cancels grams. And what we are going to get is once we do 237 divided by 18, we are going to get about, and after rounding, it's 13.2 moles of water, okay? Now, what we can do is with that value is plug it in to our equation from earlier. So that 13.2 moles can get plugged in for N. And being that we have the delta H value as well, which was 6.02 kilojoules, that can get plugged in for delta H of fusion. So let's solve Q1. So Q1 is, after getting all of our values, is 13.2 moles times 6.02 kilojoules for every mole. We can now see that that moles will cancel moles. So that's another thing. You can always let the units kind of guide your thinking and your process here. And what we will have after doing the math is about 79.5 kilojoules for Q1. Now, Q2. So Q2 is using the MCAT equation. So what exactly is happening here? Well, we have our mass, right? That's a 237. What about delta T? So delta T, for those of you who might not realize, that is the TF, so final minus initial. Now, what was our initial value? Well, looking at our curve, that was about 0 degrees Celsius and ended at about 37 degrees C. So this is our TF and our TI in our original equations that we have here. So this is why we want to make sure we're organized, labeling what we have, so that way we can see, all right, what exactly is going to be happening. So let's kind of write down our Q2 here. So this is MC delta T. M was 237 grams. Delta T is going to be final, which is 37 degrees C, minus 0 degrees C, which is just 37 degrees C. Once we subtract those. And then our C value is another value that is given to us, which is 4.186 joules over grams times Celsius. So we have all the parts. Let's plug it in. So once we do that, we have our 237 grams. We're going to multiply that times our C value. Then we're going to multiply that times our change in temperature. And what we are going to end up getting for Q, for this Q value, is being that this is in joules, this is going to be 36,707 joules. Now, can I just add the two values together? Well, if you notice from Q1, this is in kilojoules. Q2 is in joules. So what do we have to do is we have to convert them to the same unit. So it's pretty easy to convert to kilojoules, so maybe we'll just do that real quick. So if we divide 36,707 by 1,000, that will give you your joules. Oh, sorry, kilojoules. So that will be 36.7 kilojoules for one number. And then we have the other one from earlier. So let's now add them together. So Q total is going to be 36.7 kilojoules. Plus our 79.5 kilojoules from earlier. So this was Q2 and Q1. So in the very end, what you will get is 116.2 kilojoules of total energy that's required to melt an ice pack and to heat an ice pack from 0 to 37 degrees. So these heat of fusion, heat of vaporization problems can get a little involved, and they can involve a lot of steps. So if you have a multi-step heating and cooling and phase change, you gotta add up every single part. I hope this video helped you try to learn a little bit more about fusion vaporization, going through the problem walkthroughs. More videos to come. Please hit that like and subscribe button if it has been helping you. And thank you so much for your support. Please let me know what you thought down below. And I hope to see you around for future videos. Bye now.